As the large lighted globe descended from Times Square on New Year's Eve, 1939, Americans looked to the coming decade with great relief, anticipation, and more than just a glimmer of hope. We were still emerging from one of the most difficult eras of our history, the Great Depression, and we gladly said goodbye to the old year and the past decade as we welcomed in the new. We looked forward to a newly energized America, a modern society boasting new inventions, prosperity, and peace. But our hopes were tempered by the gathering thunderous clouds of war in Europe and across the Pacific. By 1938, Adolf Hitler's Nazi war machine had marched into Austria and taken Czechoslovakia, while the Japanese moved in terrifying manner through China. Still, we wanted to believe, and hoped against hope, that the life and death struggle would remain two oceans and seemingly a million miles away.
Rock-a-bye, my baby, there ain't gonna be no war. There ain't gonna be no war over here. Rock-a-bye, my baby, it's all on the other side. We ain't gonna need no ride of Paul Revere.
The songs were optimistic and romantic, sometimes silly. And the latest beat was big, broad, and bouncy, as the big jazz bands dominated the musical scene.
The only place you go marching to will be the corner grocery store. So rock-a-bye, my baby, there ain't gonna be no war.
Overseas, Hitler Youth marched to their own beat.
Deutschland erwachen aus deinem bösen Traum. Gib fremden Juden in deinem Reich nicht Raum.
Americans weren't the only ones who hoped war could simply be wished away. The Allied powers, cautious after the horrors of the First World War and drained from years of economic strife, hoped Hitler would be appeased with the territory he had taken. In 1938, Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain of Great Britain met with the Nazi Führer and came away convinced that there would be no more grabs for land in Europe. Upon his return to London, Chamberlain waved in his hand a signed pledge of friendship and promised a cheering crowd, "Peace in our time."
After my visits to Germany, I realized vividly how Herr Hitler feels that he must champion other Germans. He told me privately, and last night he repeated publicly, that after the Sudeten German question is settled, that is the end of Germany's territorial claims in Europe.
Back in the United States, as the promise of a new decade dawned, we poured nickels into jukeboxes and jitterbugged to the sound of the big bands. We stood in line to see films of adventure and romance, like Robin Hood, The Wizard of Oz, and Gone with the Wind. We shared laughs with Amos and Andy, Fibber McGee, and our other favorite radio comedians. And we gaped excitedly at the world of tomorrow, on exhibit today, at the 1939 New York World's Fair. It was a world of frozen foods that could be cooked in minutes, not of once free nations in chains. A world of dazzling new fashions, spanking new cars, and new synthetic materials like nylon. Not of millions of Jews in boxcars and extermination camps. We saw and heard about lightweight metal alloys and affordable new homes with all the modern conveniences. Space travel, and a new communications medium with sound and picture called television. Missing from this rosy picture was a life and death struggle overseas, a struggle we would have to win before we could truly taste the fruits of this new modern society. Early on, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt sought to soothe American fears and hold the country's isolationists at bay.
I have said this before, but I shall say it again and again and again. Your boys are not going to be sent into any foreign war.
On September 1st, 1939, with Americans following events over radio, Hitler unleashed his furious blitzkrieg, or lightning war, attacking Poland without warning and with a power so shattering that it shook the Allied nations. Hitler spoke and the world listened.
Those assembled arise and stand to greet the arrival of the German Führer. The applause greets the Führer who has just arrived in the Kohl Opera House to address the Reichstag, which has been called an extraordinary session.
Frankfurt war und ist eine deutsche Stadt.
Danzig was and is a German city.
Alle diese Gebiete verdanken für kulturelle Erschließung ausschließlich dem deutschen Volk.
All these regions have only Germany to thank for their cultural development.
Wenn Polen versuchen sollte, auf dem Weg zollpolitischer Maßnahmen Danzig wirtschaftlich zu vernichten, dass dann Deutschland nicht mehr länger untätig zusehen könnte.
I told the Polish ambassador 3 weeks ago that if situation continued as it was, if Danzig were persecuted and were attempted by Poland to ruin Danzig economically, the situation could not be tolerated.
We interrupt this broadcast of Adolf Hitler's speech just momentarily to report a dispatch from Paris which says that Premier Daladier of France has now called the French Council of Ministers for an emergency meeting which is to take place just 10 minutes from now at 5:30 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time.
2 days later, and more than 2 days too late, England and France declared war on Germany.
I am speaking to you from the cabinet room at 10 Downing Street. This morning, the British ambassador in Berlin handed the German government a final note stating that unless we heard from them by 11 o'clock, that they were prepared at once to withdraw their troops from Poland, a state of war would exist between us. I have to tell you now that no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently this country is at war with Germany.
Soon, the clouds of war overseas would cross to our shores. In Europe, Hitler's powerful stormtroops continued to gobble up its neighbors. In response, Britain unveiled its most potent weapon, the new prime minister, Winston Churchill. Churchill was a feisty, cigar-chomping bulldog of a man, whose leadership and defiant, impassioned words summoned the determination of the entire free world.
Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. If we can stand up to him, all Europe may be freed, and the life of the world may move forward into broad, sunlit uplands. Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duty, and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
In America, Franklin Roosevelt joined Churchill as a giant among leaders.
Once I prophesied that this generation of Americans had a rendezvous with destiny. That prophecy comes true. To us, much is given. More is expected. This generation will nobly save or meanly lose the last best hope of Earth.
In the spring of 1940, Germany broke the Allies' main line of defense, trapping the British, French, and Belgian armies in the French port of Dunkirk with their backs to the English Channel. But as the Royal Air Force battled to hold back German tanks, a miracle happened. Hundreds of British vessels of all kinds, warships and sailboats, fishing boats, ferries, and pleasure craft crossed the channel to evacuate some 300,000 soldiers to England to fight another day. It was a victory of sorts, although Churchill was quick to remind all that wars are not won by evacuations. Little more than a month later, a dispirited and weakened France fell, and the Nazi swastika was raised on the Eiffel Tower. Roosevelt recognized the danger to America and worked closely with Churchill to help provide needed weapons and supplies without outwardly breaking America's neutrality.
We must be the great arsenal of democracy. For us, this is an emergency as serious as war itself.
What is the answer that I shall give in your name to this great man? Give us the tools, and we will finish the job.
As the news overseas became more bleak, even most isolationists agreed to a draft of American men into the armed services.
The first number drawn by the Secretary of War is serial number 158.
The musical refrain, "There ain't gonna be no war," was replaced by the still upbeat, "Goodbye, dear, I'll be back in a year." In Europe, the Battle of Britain had begun.
So now the Germans are dive bombing a convoy out into the sea. There are 7 German dive bombers, Junkers 87s. There's one going down on his target now. Bomb. No, missed the ships. He hasn't hit a single ship. There are about 10 ships in the convoy. There, you can hear anti-aircraft going at them now. No, we thought he got a German one, had been got then, but now the British fighters are coming up. There's one coming down in flames. Somebody's hit a German, and he's coming down. There's a long streak. He's coming down completely out of control, a long streak of smoke. The man's bailed out by parachute. The pilot's bailed out by parachute. He's a Junkers 87, and he's going slap into the sea, and there he goes, smash! That was a bomb, as you may imagine. I can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 Germans herring back towards France now for all they can go, and here are our Spitfires coming after them.
Thanks to radio, for the first time in history, the sounds of war could be heard directly in our living rooms. War was no longer a distant rumor. We were moved by news of British children being evacuated, and we also clung to every word, as CBS reporter Edward R. Murrow described England's fight for survival.
This is Trafalgar Square. The noise that you hear at the moment is the sound of the air raid sirens. I'm standing here just on the steps of St. Martin's in the Fields. A searchlight just burst into action off in the distance. One single beam sweeping the sky above me now. People are walking along quite quietly. We're just at the entrance of an air raid shelter here, and I must move this cable over just a bit so people can walk in. I can see just straight away in front of me Lord Nelson on top of that big column. There's another searchlight just square behind Nelson's statue. I'll just let you listen to the traffic and the sound of the siren for a moment.
Our hearts stirred as England's Princess Elizabeth wished the English children well.
Thousands of you in this country have had to leave your homes and be separated from your fathers and mothers. My sister, Margaret Rose, and I feel so much for you, as we know from experience what it means to be away from those we love most of all. We know, every one of us, that in the end, all will be well. for God will care for us and give us victory and peace. And when peace comes, remember, it will be for us, the children of today, to make the world of tomorrow a better and happier place. My sister is by my side, and we are both going to say good night to you. Come on, Margaret.
Good night, children.
Good night, and good luck to you all.
And then, on the morning of December 7th, 1941, the war not only touched our hearts, it touched our soil as well.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special news bulletin. The Japanese have attacked Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, by air, President Roosevelt has just announced. The attack also was made on all naval and military activities on the principal island of Oahu.
The destruction during the first 15 minutes was incredible. Great clouds of smoke rose from defenseless ships. Runways were littered with airplane wreckage. And the casualty toll mounted. Recalled one Japanese commander, Pearl Harbor was still asleep in the morning mist. In all, some 360 Japanese warplanes with bright red suns painted on their wingtips carried out a swift, devastating two-hour attack. 19 ships were sunk and nearly 200 planes destroyed. 2,400 military personnel and civilians were killed and another 1,000 wounded.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
Americans were confident we could win any war, but the early news from land and sea was grim. In Tokyo, newspaper headlines read, "United States Pacific Fleet wiped out." It was one of the few accurate reports during the war to come from Tokyo. Throughout the world, the battered Allied armies were on the defensive. A ranting Hitler already controlled much of Western Europe, and the rest of Europe, from England to Russia, teetered on the brink of collapse. Benito Mussolini's Italy dominated the Mediterranean, and its armies joined the Nazis in swarming across North Africa. In China, Japan was firmly in control. What England's Prime Minister Winston Churchill called the long night of barbarism was descending upon the world. Back at home, Americans were up to the task at hand. On the day following Pearl Harbor, President Roosevelt again spoke.
We are going to win the war, and we are going to win the peace that follows.
The musical refrain, once boasting the optimism of, "I'll be back in a year," now rang out with, "Goodbye, Mama, I'm off to Yokohama." The Allied countries were confident that over time, America's industrial might could churn out the materials needed to defeat the surging Axis armies. The plan was to hold the enemy at bay, a policy of containment, while America geared up for the mammoth war effort that lay ahead. But the Japanese had other plans. At the Battle of the Island of Midway, Japan hoped to finish off America's naval fleet. But America's crack code breakers learned of the plan, and Japan suffered its first major loss of the war. Elsewhere, however, the Japanese continued to sweep through the Pacific.
They're not near yet. We are waiting for God only knows what. How about a chocolate soda? Not many. Not near yet. Lots of heavy fighting going on. We've only got about 1 hour, 20 minutes before we may have to give up by noon. We don't know yet. They are throwing men and shells at us, and we may not be able to stand it. They have been shelling us faster than you can count. We've got about 55 minutes, and I feel sick at my stomach. I am really low down. They are around now, smashing rifles. They bring in the wounded every minute. It is a horrible sight. We will be waiting for you guys to help. This is the only thing, I guess, that can be done. General Wainwright is a right guy, and we are willing to go on for him. But shells were dropping all night, faster than hell. Damage terrific. Too much for guys to take. Enemy heavy cross-shelling and bombing. They have got us all around and from skies. From here, it looks like firing ceased on both sides. Men here all feeling bad because of terrific nervous strain of the siege. Corregidor used to be a nice place. It's haunted now.
For nearly a year, the Allies endured a string of disastrous defeats in places like Hong Kong and Singapore, Guam and Bataan. Despite a brave stand against insurmountable odds, without supplies or hopes of relief, General Jonathan Wainwright, commander at Bataan, was forced to send this sad message of surrender.
This is Lieutenant General Wainwright. Subject, surrender. It became apparent that the garrison's reserve forces would be eventually destroyed by aerial and artillery bombardment and by infantry supported by tanks which have overwhelmed Corregidor. After leaving General Homer with no agreement between us, I decided to accept, in the name of humanity, his proposal. You will therefore be guided accordingly, and will, repeat, will, surrender all troops under your command to the proper Japanese officers. This decision, on my part, it was realized, was forced upon me by means entirely beyond my control.
Perhaps most agonizing of all, in March of 1942, General Douglas MacArthur was ordered to abandon the Philippines. Despite these early defeats, America was still confident, perhaps too confident. German U-boat captains were astonished to see the lights of American cities burning brightly at night, providing an easy backdrop for sinking freighters and tankers off the Atlantic coast. The lights did not last, and neither did the supremacy of the Axis powers. America's best weapon, its mighty factories, natural resources, and the will of a free people on the home front, helped turn the tide.
Lend Uncle Sam a dime to win this war, and he'll pay you back with interest when he's won it. The easiest, most convenient way to lend him these dimes is to enroll in the payroll savings plan. Just tell your boss to deduct 10 cents from every dollar he pays you and lend it to Uncle Sam in your name. Sign up for this simple savings plan today, and when victory comes, you will have war bonds in your pockets instead of Axis bonds on your wrists.
You can have vegetables, lots of them, on your table next winter.
You can have your own fresh vegetables on your table this summer if you have your own Victory Garden. Yes, there's no restriction on home canning and home processing of vegetables and garden fruits and berries. Plan your Victory Garden now. Get your garden plot lined up. Get the advice of a garden expert if you need it. And be prepared to grow your own for victory.
The shooting was far away, but Americans at home pitched in where and when they could. The slogan in 1942 was, "Give till it hurts. Give blood for soldiers overseas. Buy U.S. war bonds. Carpool to work. Turn in those stockings to make powder bags for naval guns. Donate old pots and pans, tin cans, rubber tires, and anything else that could be turned into fighting arms."
Junk ain't junk no more, 'cause junk can win the war. What's junk to you? Job to do, 'cause junk ain't junk no more. Pots and pans, old garbage cans, the kettle that doesn't pour. Collect today for the USA, 'cause junk can win the war.
Aluminum for defense. This is Frank Dunn speaking to you from the Stork Club, where an aluminum collection party is now in progress. Standing before our mutual microphone right now is one of the screen's most lovely singers and actresses, Kitty Carlisle. Kitty, do you think it's a good idea for people around the country to give aluminum collection parties such as this party here at the Stork Club tonight?
I think it's a simply wonderful idea. And if you're like me and you don't really know the difference between tin and aluminum, it doesn't make any difference. Bring everything you have, because the more the merrier.
And still another of the famous persons here at the Stork Club tonight is lovely Miss Josette Daly, New York debutante. What is your contribution, Miss Daly?
Oh, gobs of bracelets and hair curlers.
Well, will you just chuck it in the box over there, Miss Daly?
Our boys are still fighting. Are you still saving used fat? It's urgently needed to help make battlefront and home front supplies.
Remember, the government ruling is you must register your tires or you cannot get any gas. So act tomorrow to register yours.
Oh, what can I serve for a main dish tonight?
You're short on time and ration points, right? Well, have macaroni and cheese made the Kraft dinner way. Cooks in 7 minutes.
What did you say?
Just 7 minutes for a dish that's a winner.
Then I'll certainly try this Kraft dinner.
There's a lady that's going to save time and ration points. She'll get 2 boxes of Kraft dinner for a single ration point. Main dishes for 2 separate meals. And what swell macaroni and cheese. Try it yourself. Ask for Kraft dinner.
Products like meat and butter, sugar and coffee, cheese and gasoline were rationed.
How do you do, ladies and gentlemen? This is Bob, USO Show Hope, telling all you people that I just found out I'm leaving immediately for overseas and I'm all a flutter. Besides, it's the only way I can get cigarettes and butter.
The manufacture of clothing was limited, which affected fashions more than anything else. And a speed limit of 35 miles per hour was clamped onto the nation's highways. The old family car would have to do, as factories converted into manufacturing plants for planes, guns, and tanks. Although such sacrifices hardly equal the horrors endured by peoples across the globe, Americans were eager to help in any way they could. Remarked the Nazi Hermann Göring, "Americans can't build planes, only electric iceboxes and razor blades." But thousands of tanks rolled off the assembly lines at Chrysler. B-17s were made by Boeing. Barrage balloons came from General Tire and Rubber. Army trucks from GM. President Roosevelt publicly promised that U.S. factories would supply the Allies with 60,000 planes each year, a boast that Charles Lindbergh called idle chatter. Indeed, Roosevelt had miscalculated. By the end of 1942, we manufactured over 86,000 planes. We also put men in uniforms, 6 million that first year, 12 million by 1943, onto the battlefields, up in the skies, and onto ships across 2 oceans. Most of the guys were regular Joes, but there were also the familiar names, the entertainers, the celebrities, and athletes who went to war. In the boxing ring, Joe Louis was world champion. But Louis was an even bigger champion, and yet just another average Joe, when in 1942 he entered the Army as a private. Here he speaks at a bond rally in New York's Madison Square Garden.
I've only done what any
red blood American would do. We're going to do our part, and we will win because we are on God's side.
Americans listened when their entertainers and sports heroes spoke. It helped build morale and pushed factory workers to selflessly continue their important jobs. The legendary Babe Ruth and Connie Mack.
Babe, you and I made that trip to Japan in 1934, and what a beating we gave those boys over there. But it's nothing to the beating that Uncle Sam is going to give them.
I second the motion on that, Connie.
As America's factories retooled, massive unemployment gave way to a labor shortage as good wages attracted people to defense-related jobs. 17 million women joined the labor force, with some 5 million in defense work. 60,000 women served the Red Cross as Army and Navy nurses. The Navy had the waves, the Coast Guard the spars, and the Women's Army Corps, better known as WACS, boasted 100,000 women.
Between now and then, if you're a woman between 20 and 50, if you're not now in a war job, if you have no children under 14, and if you've had 2 years of high or business school, the Army's got work for you. Work that's vital to victory. The Army wants to bring enlistments in the WAC up to 200,000. That means 200,000 more soldiers for combat, while members of the WAC take over technical jobs in communications, transport, and Air Force, and X-ray photography, and medical and dental labs, in 155 different branches of Army service that the WAC is trained to handle. The Women's Army Corps trains you. The career is yours forever. The pay is that of a soldier of equal rank. There's a really important job waiting in the WAC for every gal who is anxious to serve her country at home or overseas. The WAC has a recruiting office not far from you. To do your part in hastening the ultimate victory of our forces, to speed them back, join the WAC.
World War II marked a new era in communications. Like never before, the voices and sounds of war could be heard by Americans in their homes.
This is London, and this is the fourth Christmas Eve. The beef eaters may have become spam eaters, but no one has seen Scrooge about tonight. Our men have been giving parties for British children. They have made toys of odd bits of wood and metal. Big, tough sergeants have played Santa Claus. Thousands of British children, especially the orphans and the poor, have had a memorable time thanks to the Americans. Our men are the best fed, best paid, and best uniformed soldiers in this war. And this Christmas, they have certainly maintained the American tradition of good-natured generosity. Some of them are a little homesick, but you couldn't tell it by looking at them. I've asked many of them what they'd like to say if they were talking to America tonight. And most of them have said, well, you see, it's a little tough to know what to say. But you know how it is. I've an idea. Most of them would tell you, don't worry too much. We're all right. And we're amongst friends. And some of them on this dark night might repeat the words written a long time ago. Though there be darkness, it shall be as the morning. And thou shalt be secure. Because there is hope.
Radio and newspaper correspondents, 500 in all, rode bombers over Berlin, rode on landing crafts to the Pacific Islands, and traveled with ground troops so they could deliver first-hand accounts of the battlefront.
Berlin last night wasn't a pretty sight. In about 35 minutes, it was hit with about three times the amount of stuff that ever came down on London in a night-long blitz. Men die in the sky while others are roasted alive in their cellars. This is a calculated, remorseless campaign of destruction. Berlin was a kind of orchestrated hell, a terrible symphony of light and flame. It isn't a pleasant kind of warfare. I return you now to CBS New York.
You can hear the kind of flak that those planes are flying through. It's absolutely like hail up there. These enemy guns all around us are just simply hammering at those planes. But so far I haven't seen anything, seen any of them hit. But the bundles are coming down. The parachutes are coming down. That's all that these men ask.
During the First World War, to be German was to be called a Kraut. and that favorite American food, sauerkraut, was dubbed Liberty Cabbage. But during the Second World War, with the stakes seemingly higher, Americans erupted with a fury on the men, women, and children of Japanese heritage who lived in this country. Many were second or third generation Americans, guaranteed the same rights as all other citizens. But the very day after Pearl Harbor, funds belonging to Japanese Americans in California were frozen, and banks refused to cash their checks. Milkmen refused to deliver their milk, and grocers refused to sell them food. Early in 1942, the entire population of Japanese Americans living in the western United States were given 48 hours to dispose of their homes, businesses, and furnishings. Taking only what they could carry by hand, they reported to internment camps. There, they lived in squalid conditions behind barbed wire, sweeping prison lights, and guns. They suffered the injustice against them with incredible dignity and patience. In 1943, the 442nd Infantry was formed, consisting solely of Japanese Americans, including 1,200 who signed up from behind the barbed wire of the camps. Fighting in Italy, the 442nd suffered the highest casualty rate and chalked up the most combat decorations, including 3,600 Purple Hearts of any regiment. In the Pacific, they went close enough to enemy lines, despite the danger of being shot by both sides, to hear and translate enemy commands. As America's industrial war machine supplied the materials, Allied troops began to turn the tide of war. By 1943, plans were underway for an all-out invasion of Nazi-held lands on the European continent. Allied planes made bombing runs that saturated Germany, Austria, and occupied France.
Is that bombs gone?
Yes.
Okay.
Bomb doors closed.
Flank directly beneath us.
Right.
And searchlights underneath us too.
How many searchlights would you call them?
Too many, I reckon.
A couple of thousand.
Yeah, they're searching for us. You bastard. Oh, hell. Certainly illuminates things, doesn't it? They're firing at us now.
Are they?
Yeah.
Okay. Flag closed. You'll light your fag on any of those.
I think we've been hit personally.
Hello, Skipper.
Hello?
We've been holding the front here.
Okay.
The oil's leaking out of the front turret, so there's nothing to worry about.
Okay.
Okay, boy.
Only there's a few searchlights ahead, about 100.
Yeah.
Boy, good, I've never seen anything like this before.
Neither have I. 4,000 pounder just gone off.
Good show.
By July of 1943, Allied troops invaded Sicily, and Benito Mussolini was placed under house arrest.
My fellow Americans, over a year and a half ago, I said this to the Congress. The militarists in Berlin and Rome and Tokyo started this war, but the massed, angered forces of common humanity will finish it. I think the first crack in the axis has come.
By the spring of 1944, plans for the great invasion were complete. On the early morning of June 6, 1944, the D-Day landing began. From 100 harbors, 4,000 Allied ships, comprising the largest invasion armada the world had ever known, steamed into the English Channel and headed for the French coast. The weather was miserable. The seas rough. Partly for that reason, Hitler thought the landing was a bluff, expecting the real invasion to take place 150 miles away. Hitler refused to commit his reserves and went back to bed to sleep until 3 p.m. By nightfall, the Allies had landed some 150,000 troops onto France's Normandy beaches.
Almighty God, our sons, pride of our nation, this day have set upon a mighty endeavor, a struggle to preserve our republic, our religion, and our civilization. and to set free a suffering humanity.
The Supreme Commander of the operation, General Dwight Eisenhower, spoke to the people of Europe.
A landing was made this morning on the coast of France by troops of the Allied Expeditionary Force. This landing is part of the concerted United Nations plan for the liberation of Europe, made in conjunction with our great Russian allies.
On D-Day, radio was there, as war correspondents rode the landing vessels and walked the beaches, then brought their tapes back to London for broadcast.
This is Charles Collingwood. We are on the beach today, on D-Day.
This place even smells like an invasion. It has a curious odor, which we always associate with modern war. It's a smell of oil and high explosive and burning things. What I wanted to do most of all was just to get ashore and reach down and take up a handful of sand and say, this is France, and I've got it in my hand. France at last after 4 years.
NBC's Tom Traynor from a Normandy beach.
To reach the palisade, I joined a column who were wading across a slough. The water came nearly to their armpits, and they had to hold their rifles and equipment over their heads. The water was rather warm, but the bottom was a slimy mess. When a man got to the far side of the slough, he would always stop in a maddening way, holding the rest of us up. We shouted angrily, but when we got there, each one of us stopped too. The reeds on the far bank were loaded with mines. One man lay at the top of the bank dead. The mines had been marked with bits of paper, and soldiers at the top advised just how to climb so as not to venture into dangerous ground.
There were more dead men along the narrow path which led up the palisade.
Suddenly a voice said,
"Watch yourself, fellow, that's a mine."
ABC's George Hicks from the invasion flagship Ancon.
Here we go again, another plane's come over. Looks like we're going to have a night tonight.
Something's burning. It's falling down through the sky. It's circling down. Maybe a hit plane.
There he goes.
They got one. They got one.
We got that one. It's gone right here.
Did we?
Yeah.
For this one? Great blots of fire came down and is smoldering now just off our port side in the sea.
In less than a week, 326,000 men and 54,000 vehicles were put ashore. Within a month's time, more than 1 million Allied troops were in France. As the summer wore on, the Battle of France turned into a rout. On August 25th, 1944, Paris was liberated. As Allied troops entered the city, the bells of Notre Dame rang out. Flowers cascaded from balconies amid shouts of Vive la France. People in the streets embraced one another. Across Europe, the Germans were in retreat. Finally, the Allies poured into Germany from all sides, and Hitler's so-called thousand-year Reich was near an end. Back on the home front, President Roosevelt sought an unprecedented fourth term. At the Democratic Convention, a new running mate for Roosevelt was picked, a little-known senator from Missouri, Harry S. Truman. When the results of the balloting were announced, Truman was sitting on the main platform eating a sandwich, and he had to be dragged to the microphone by a fellow senator.
Upon being nominated for the office of Vice President of the United States, my first wish was to express my appreciation to the membership of the Democratic Party. Franklin Delano Roosevelt is my leader and commander-in-chief.
As their candidate, the Republicans nominated Governor Thomas E. Dewey of New York.
This election will bring an end to one-man government in America. Let me make it crystal clear that a change of administration next January cannot and will not involve any change in the military conduct of the war. All they tell us is that in its young days, it did some good things. That we freely grant. But now it has grown old in office.
The president's health had severely deteriorated over 12 long years of the presidency. He was gaunt and ill, but he battled Republican charges that he was a tired old man by campaigning harder than ever, making more speeches, even riding in the rain in open cars without a hat.
You know, I am actually 4 years older, which is a fact that seems to annoy some people. These Republican leaders have not been content with attacks on me, or on my wife, or on my sons. They now include my little dog, Fowler. You know, Fowler's Scotch. And being a Scotty, as soon as he learned that the Republican fiction writers had concocted a story that I'd left him behind on an Aleutian island and had sent a destroyer back to find him at a cost to the taxpayers of $2 or $3 or $8 or $20 million, his Scotch soul was furious.
The election was close. Closer than any Roosevelt had waged before. But ultimately, he won a fourth term. His inauguration speech was short and to the point.
Today, in this year of war, 1945, we have learned lessons at a fearful cost, and we shall profit by them. We have learned that we cannot live alone, at peace, that our own well-being is dependent on the well-being of other nations far away. We have learned that we must live as men and not as ostriches, nor as dogs in the manger. We have learned to be citizens of the world, members of the human community. We have learned the simple truth, as Emerson said, that the only way to have a friend is to be one.
Japan stubbornly hung on, vowing to fight until the bitter end. Their fanatical loyalty to the cause is best exemplified by the kamikaze pilots who, strapped into their cockpits, purposely crashed their planes into American ships.
The first raids were mass raids, and they would send them down in daylight by the hundreds. And this was extremely costly to them, too. Of course, it hurt us badly. The Navy, I don't think, ever had such losses as they had at Okinawa. The ones that I saw that did the most harm were single planes. I remember one night we were standing on deck, and all of a sudden, here was a plane right in our midst. It was not more than 10 feet off the waves, it seems to me. Well, this guy's coming right down the line of ships, you know. And in order to fire at him, you had to endanger other vessels. Boy, there's more shrapnel flying around our bridge from other vessels. But this guy skimmed right through the whole thing with no trouble at all, struck a ship in front of us, and exploded.
I thought the kamikaze was great, and I was thinking, if I growing up, I wish to be one of them. You know, the whole entire education started when I was baby, and was taught that empire is a god. And, I was glad to die for the country, of course, and to empire, in other words, his god. I believed it, and my brother, he was so proud to be chosen as one of Kamikaze members. And we, our family, of course, proud of him. Like, I think maybe one of your family become a priest or a nun.
But America's momentum could not be stopped. On October 25th, General MacArthur made good on his pledge to the Philippines.
People of the Philippines, I have returned. By the grace of Almighty God, our forces stand again on Philippine soil.
We're Marines and we're fighting like hell, heading for Tokyo.
On the island of Iwo Jima, which was little more than a dead volcano surrounded by ashes, America and Japan engaged in some of the bloodiest fighting of the war, as Japanese soldiers battled from an extensive underground system of caves and tunnels. It would be 3 weeks before the Marines could take control of the island.
And now we're streaking in to the line of departure. That means we are going to the line from which we will shortly leave. You can hear our motor, the engine of this tank glider, roaring as we move quickly through the water up to a distance of about 2,000 yards from the shore. There's all hell to pay directly ahead of us. The beach looks as though it's practically on fire.
There we've hit it. We're grounding on it. We're up on it. We're up on it. In a minute, the ramp will go down, and the men are going to stream out. Man, Tom has just wished everybody good luck. Everybody's sort of... Machine gun just fired. Our machine gun just fired from the south side. 3 or 4 shots, you probably heard it. The men are now going out ahead. They're moving out ahead of the half track. Well, there's one boy been hit. One boy's been hurt now. They're putting him into the rubber boat. 4 men putting him into the rubber boat. I don't know who it is. Can't see him. But he has been hurt. And he's lying on his side. Another boy's just been hit. Another boy's been hit. But I think he's been killed. The officer is hollering at him to get him. No, he's all right. He's climbed into the rubber boat. And I guess he's all right. There's a lot of fire around us now. We're almost at shore. I should say about 100 feet or a little more from shore. There are 2 Marines now in our rubber boat. Another boy's just been hurt. He's hanging onto the tail with both arms. They tell him to throw up while they stick a guy in the tail. Oh, there's one Marine lying on his back. Now we're at the beach. There's one Marine lying on his back with blood pouring out of him into the water. And here, we're reaching the beach now. We're going to come up on it. And there's fire all around us. And the Marines are still on the beach. They have not made any further headway. At least there's a whole, must be 2 or 3 waves here on the beach. In fact, all of the half tracks are lined up now around us on the beach. None of them have been able to move past here.
The price in lives was devastating. Every American unit suffered at least 50% casualties. Iwo Jima lives in American memories for a reason other than its strategic importance. It was here, on a hill some 550 feet above sea level, that the first American flag was planted on Japanese soil.
Up the precipitous side of a 600-foot extinct volcano, so precipitous that it seemed almost vertical, went a platoon of American Marines. Even through a glass, they seemed tiny figures scrambling skyward against a background of blue. And then a few minutes later, from the thousands of throats upon ships and on land and sea, came the sudden cry, "There goes the flag." That was how the stars and stripes went up on the first island of Japan's outer rim of island defenses.
On the evening of April 12th, 1945, with victory so close at hand, the nation mourned.
We interrupt this program to bring you a special news bulletin from CBS World News. A press association has just announced that President Roosevelt is dead. The president died of a cerebral hemorrhage. All we know so far is that the president died at Warm Springs in Georgia.
As Roosevelt was taken by train from Warm Springs, Georgia, to Washington, D.C., huge crowds of people lined the route to pay their last respects. While millions listened on the radio, Arthur Godfrey described the funeral procession.
The drums are wrapped in black crepe and are muffled, as you can hear. And the pace of the musicians is so slow. And behind them, these are Navy boys. And now just coming past the treasury, I can see the horses drawing the caisson. And most generally, folks having as tough a time as I am trying to see it. And behind us is the car bearing the man on whose shoulders now falls the terrific burdens and responsibilities that were handled so well by the man to whose body we're paying our last respects now. God bless him, President Truman.
As Allied troops continued to advance across Europe and into Germany, they were horrified to discover the evil monstrosities committed by the Nazis and their sympathizers at Buchenwald and Belsen, Auschwitz, and other terrible concentration camps where 6 million Jews and millions more were put to their death and experimented upon. Edward Murrow viewed the nightmare that was Buchenwald.
It is on a small hill about 4 miles outside Weimar, and it was one of the largest concentration camps in Germany. And it was built to last. They showed me the children, hundreds of them. Some were only 6. One rolled up his sleeve, showed me his number. It was tattooed on his arm. D-6030 it was. The others showed me their numbers. They will carry them till they die. Murder had been done at Buchenwald. God alone knows how many men and boys have died there during the last 12 years. Thursday, I was told that there were more than 20,000 in the camp. There had been as many as 60,000. Where are they now?
An English reporter was on hand at the liberation of the camp at Belsen.
When our spearhead entered the camp, we found the bodies of 35,000 dead lying about the camp, and among them, 30,000 living. What I saw there myself will always haunt me. Living people too weak to move the dead off them. Living people lying on the dead as pillows. Heaps of raw mangelwurzels among the dead, the only food the prisoners had had for days before our arrival. Typhus everywhere. 1,500 young children.
On May 8th, 1945, came news the whole world was waiting to hear.
The National Broadcasting Company delays the start of all its programs to bring you a special bulletin.
It was announced in San Francisco half an hour ago by a high American official not identified as saying that Germany has surrendered unconditionally to the Allies, no strings attached.
I only wish that Franklin D. Roosevelt had lived to witness this day. General Eisenhower informs me that the forces of Germany have surrendered to the United Nations. The flags of freedom fly all over Europe.
This is your victory. Victory of the cause of freedom is every day. In all our long history, we have never seen a greater day than this.
Whether or not you know it, I am now a Londoner myself. I've got just as much right to be down in that crowd yelling as you have. The great difference that I see in this city and when I came 3 years ago is right here. We can now have crowds. There can be happy gatherings. You don't have to listen for a motor in the sky and wonder whether there's a pilot in the blankety-blank thing or not.
The German war is at an end. We may allow ourselves a brief period of rejoicing. But let us not forget for a moment the toils and efforts that lie ahead.
Japan continued to fight fiercely. And President Truman was faced with perhaps the most difficult decision in history, whether to drop America's new secret weapon, the atomic bomb. One observer at a test site described the bomb's awesome roar as sounding like doomsday. But the argument that an all-out assault on Japan would cost untold American and Japanese lives convinced Truman that the weapon he had known nothing about while vice president had to be used. On August 6th, 1945, the Enola Gay, a B-29, dropped a single atomic bomb over the city of Hiroshima. Described as brighter than a thousand suns, the bomb immediately incinerated tens of thousands of people, melted steel and concrete, and flattened the entire city.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
The world will note that the first atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, a military base. We won the race of discovery against the Germans. We have used it in order to shorten the agony of war, in order to save the lives of thousands and thousands of young Americans. We shall continue to use it until we completely destroy Japan's power to make war.
A second bomb was dropped over the city of Nagasaki. The Japanese surrendered the following day.
7 p.m. Eastern wartime, Bob Trout reporting. The Japanese have accepted our terms fully. That's the word we've just received from the White House in Washington. This, ladies and gentlemen, is the end of the Second World War. The United Nations on land, on the sea, in the air, and to the four corners of the earth are united and are victorious.
It rates an ovation, knows that I'm in a state of elation. Calls the press in, I've got a quotation. Tells the nation, my guys come back no more.
We are gathered here, representatives of the major warring powers, to conclude a solemn agreement whereby peace may be restored. I now invite the representatives of the Emperor of Japan and the Japanese government and the Japanese Imperial General Headquarters to sign the instrument of surrender at the places indicated.
3 years, 8 months, 25 days after Japan's attack on Pearl Harbor, the long nightmare was over. VJ Day, victory over Japan, was at hand.
People who have seen Times Square celebrations before declare that this is the biggest spectacle in New York history. Estimates of the crowd go beyond a half million.
To some generations, much is given. Of other generations, much is expected. This generation of Americans has a rendezvous with destiny.